conventional rule, the difference already carried this over 2 mass eigenstate. But here, okay, let's assume there's no CP violation for simplicity. So that means the mass eigenstate is just the CP eigenstate, because that means the coefficient P and Q are roughly equal. So you have the D plus D bar, D minus D bar. Okay, so now, so you put, then, so the mass eigenstate will be the same as the CP eigenstate. So then, so you can y approximate y by this the decay which is between the CP eigenstate. Then according to definition, this is the definition of the decay which is, so d plus decay into the arbitrary finite state. Then divided by gamma bar, so you get the branch ratio. So this is just the definition, d plus decay and the difference between d plus decay and d minus decay. Okay, then you know the D plus is the linear combination of the D0 and D0 bar. So you can write this for D plus K, okay, in terms of the D0 and D0 bar K. You know that this is written as a linear combination. So you get this form, very small. So the rho n is the phase space vector, because you know the final state have different mass. So the phase space for final state should be different. And the eta Cp, okay, this is the Cp eigenvalue of some final state. So in this case, you can relate this n bar. Okay, you relate these two amplitude through this Cp transformation. So then you can write this difference of the branch ratio into this form, okay, in terms of D0 and D0 bar. Okay. And then you transform D0 bar into D0. Okay, so you get this form. Yeah. And then you further write this expression into the final one. Then you have the square root of the branch ratio D0 to N and D0 to N bar. And the delta N is a strong phase between these two amplitudes. So it's very difficult to get this strong phase. It's very difficult. So we need to know the strong phase between D0 to N and D0 to N bar. And the eta Cp is here. And the eta Ckn is another factor, which is minus 1 to the power of Ns. That is the number of strange quarks. So in fact, this minus sign comes from the so-called U-spin transformation. I will explain this later. Okay. So now, if you want to use our exclusive approach, you need to calculate the contribution from each decay mode. This so-called exclusive. You need to calculate the contribution from each decay mode. So you cannot just know the branch ratio. You need to know more detail. You need to know the strong phase, okay, of the decay mode. So this is very difficult. The difficult part appears here. Okay.
But so you still assume that the D quark changes.
D quark.
D quark the transition. So
D quark transition. D right. Meson. D quark.
D quark.
D quark. Why?
No. I just think you are exclusive. We know it should be the meson decay.
Right. So D meson decay. Yeah, so you take the contribution for each decay mode. So you sum over n, right? So this is sum over n here. So it means you count the contribution for each decay mode. This is the definition of the decay weights. You sum the decay weights for each mode, you get total decay weights.
Yeah, but
so you take a difference.
So you must have a model of this D meson wave function.
No. Okay. You will see. It depends on approach. So in a general way's approach, okay, now you got this final form, right? So then you have data input for the branch ratio. The experimentalist has measured branch ratio of each mode, right? But the point is that they don't know the
strong phase.
Strong phase. They don't know the strong phase. So that's why the Haiyang and the Zheng Wei got this value with a huge uncertainty. Okay, this is because they don't know delta n. So they just assume delta n equal to zero. So just assume this. They cannot do too much. So they just assume this. Then, so then you see that the all the data error will accumulate such that the, so basically this, you have this formula and they just input the data of the potential to get this result. So all the data error accumulate. That's why they got a huge error. Okay. So if with this huge error, then we cannot say whether we have understood trend mixing or not because of the other.
I thought you previously quoted them as 0.1%. It was on the same page, right?
Right, 0.1%, right.
Order
of magnitude.
Point 0.1 and 0.3 is differing by order of magnitude, our usual convention. And also the error bar, you know, just for two body modes is already of order 0.3. So just to
in fact, we do a very precise calculation. In fact, the confusion is smaller than 0.3, smaller, called two body. So that means that the multi-particle decay must be included. That's why it's very difficult. Okay, you will see. You jump too fast, okay? Yeah. Now, here there's some further study, more study in the literature. So for example, we know that, I just said that the charm mixing comes from the SU3 symmetry breaking. So then there are many sources of the symmetry breaking. So for example, this group people consider the one of the sources on the phase space, because you have different final state, so different have different phase space. So they calculate the contribution from this source. And Haiyang and Zhen Wei use the topological diagrammatic approach, but their approach is based on the SU3 signature. So in principle, they cannot calculate the charm mixing. That's why they have to rely on the data input for the branch ratio. But if you rely on data input and you don't know the strong phase, so they assume data input is there. Okay, they get a result with a huge uncertainty. And another group, okay, so Gronau and Rosner, they use the so-called U-spin. Okay, what's the U-spin? U-spin, as I said, is a subgroup of SU3. So it's just related to the transformation between the D and the S. So the D and the S form a spin of U-spin. And S bar and the minus D bar form another pair of the U spin. So the minus sign, okay, I just mentioned the eta CKM, right? So if you have a one strange quark, you have a strange quark, you get a minus sign. This minus sign, in fact, you can trace back, and it comes from this minus sign, the minus sign. Or it's found the minus sign in the U spin spinner. Okay, so, and so the in it, I think this work, is quite useful, okay? Because they found that the charm mixing, okay, if you want to get a non-vanished charm mixing, it must come from the second order U-spin symmetry breaking effect. Second order, because okay, if there's a symmetry, certainly you don't get a charm mixing. But to the first order of a symmetry breaking, which is proportion to the mass difference, right? As I said, proportion to the mass difference, ms minus nd. But ms, this operator, is proportion to the ss bar, dd bar. And the ss bar, dd bar, is a u spin 1, u equal to 1. And you know that the d is a u spin singlet, because it contains only c and u, nothing to do with d and s. So the u spin singlet contract is a u equal to 1 operator, you get 0. So they claim that the non-vanishing charm mixing will come from the second order. So they expect that the charm mixing is very, very small, unless, okay, in this case, because they conjecture, they already conjecture that the important contribution should come from multi-body final state. Because in this case, you have a three-body decay, four-body decay, so that means that there's a stronger soft dynamics. If there's a strong soft dynamics, then the symmetry breaking effect will be stronger. Okay, there's a stronger soft dynamics. So they have conjecture that the multi-particle final state should contribute more abundant to charm mixing. So I think that this is very important. Okay. Yeah. So in fact, our study confirmed this conjecture. Okay.
You mean in the measurements of the CP violation or those X and Y, the final state should be multi-body?
Yeah.
No, no, you have two body
right.
final state,
right.
three body, four body. But because for two body, because it's more energetic, so you spin symmetry, and should be hold, so you hold better. So that means that if once you spin symmetry, it's better than this low equation. So they conjecture that the dominant contribution should come from multi-body final state. Because you have more particle in the final state, you consume more charge mass. So then the energy release is small. So dynamics dominate, the U spin signature is not a good signature. Yeah. So that's why they conjecture the multi party final state should contribute dominantly.
Okay. The measurement is based on time evolution.
Yes, I understand.
But what produces X and Y are these kind of scattering effects.
Right.
So they'll confuse
right.
Your measurement
yeah.
cannot
right.
really distinguish.
Two
or three
QCD scale effects.
Right.
So they'll make some.
Right. Experimentally, this is just a major time evolution.
Yes.
So for time evolution, they can it because delta M describes the frequency,
right.
and the gamma describes the decay of the oscillation. So for time evolution, they can determine they can check the X and Y. But for theorists, okay, if we use the exclusive approach, you have to calculate the contribution for each mode. And then we found that in fact the multi-particle final state should be more important.
I thought the multi-particle thing was already the main point of the fork at all.
But that's the considered only phase space. Okay, so now let's introduce our approach. We call it the fraction-assisted topological material approach. Because I just mentioned the Haiyan and the general has used the topological material. So we just and refine the approach, okay, such that we can describe a SU switching break. Okay, so that's the point. So you see, they have defined the tree MLT, color suppressed tree. But it is annihilation, okay, because the D lanes are annihilated into a W annihilation. It's a W change, okay. It changed the W between the charm quark and the spectator quark. So they label these different amplitude. Okay, you see the TCAE. Okay, this is so-called the topological amplitude approach. So then they just write the amplitude in terms of the linear combination of these four. Then they use this parameterized linear combination to fit to the charm decay data, and then they can determine TCAE. Okay, this is so-called the topological amplitude approach. So now but if we add this fraction assisted way, then okay, we do the things in the following way. So we calculate, in fact, we should say we parameterize, okay, the topological amplitude in fraction. So we will further handle, parameterize, for example, the tree amplitude, the C amplitude, okay. And first, we separate the short distance contribution and the long distance. Schrodinger's contribution will go into the Wilson coefficient because we know we can describe a weak decay. We have weak decay Antonian here, okay, for this part. So we can, this laptop can absorb Schrodinger's the dynamics. So we have a Wilson coefficient to describe this Schrodinger's part. Then for the long distance part, which concerns the non term effects here in the final state, in the initial state, this part, long distance part, can be absorbed into the hadronic major element. Of the four fermion operators. Okay, so now I show you some more detail. So for example, what's the fraction assisted T and C? So instead of just writing T, we write T in this way. So you see, we have decay constant to describe is the emitting mass decay constant, emitting constant here. Then we have form factor here, D2. Final state meson, so we have form factor here. So we just factorize this T into more detail, okay, into more to separate the different the dynamics. So you can see that you have decay constant, form factor, okay. Then this is the phase space. So the Wilson coefficient here is hand from the weak decay Antonian. This part collects the short distance contribution. So the A1 is initially written in this form, A2 written in this form. This is a Paris standard. But here we added the kind NF. This is a sort of non-horizon contribution. Okay. That's because for this and that combination, okay, these are very smaller. So the non-horizon contribution should be more important here. So we parameterize the non-horizon contribution into the chi NF. Okay, mu is the related to energy release in the Dmax zone state. So you can see that it depends on the final state mass. R2 is the final state mass. So if the mass is larger, the energy release is smaller. So we have used the decay constant, form factor, non-horizable, and also the resistance scale to collect SU3 single breaking. This is still not a complete sources of SU3 single breaking. There are too many sources. Okay, we cannot exhaust all of them. But however, we try to do our best. So we think it may come from here, may come from the form factor, may come from running here, or it may come from the non-horizable contribution. Yeah. We try to do our best.
But those, like A1,
this
is the
Western coefficients. Yeah.
Do you need other inputs to get?
No, this is given. It's from the plus, and then it's operated as taken as a Western coefficient. Just use it. Yeah, but certainly the scale chose will depend on the final state mass. And there is a penetration for the A and the E. So you can see that this described the strengths and the phase here. So you can see we differentiate the light quark and the S quark. Means the fusion means the light. This quark pair pumping out from the vacuum can be light or open S. And we differentiate the light quark and the S quark contribution. So it means that we have further, as you see, signature breaking here from the vacuum. Okay. The quark pair produced from the vacuum should be different. Okay. And certainly the phase rotation can be different. Okay, so we parameterize all the four decay materials. Then we use our parametration, okay, to fit the data, Dmax zone brain tracer data. They are abundant, precise, neutral Dmax zone brain tracer data. So we shall fit and determine all these parameters. So for example, for D to PB decay, there are 13 modes. Okay, we have 13 modes, the 13 data. And we have 7 parameters. So the chi-squared particular freedom is about 1.1. So let me say it's a very good fit. And then for D to PV mode, we have 9 free parameters. There were 19 pieces of data. And then the chi-square particular freedom is a 0.28, which is also okay.
Shannon, sorry, for the T and C, what's the difference between your approach and the so-called generalized factorization approach?
Same. Because it's the same. Yeah. But for the decay, but the exchange and the annihilation, our approach is different. Yeah. Okay, so you can see, in fact, the fit is very good. Fit is very good. So you can see, there's the exponential value for the approach ratio is our fit. So, and for the major part, we have our prediction. Okay, basically, PPPP fit very well. So we have confidence to use this result to calculate the charm mixing. Okay, so you see, this is you according to the formula for the charm mixing. Okay, in the exclusive approach, where we have the branch ratio. These are from the eta CKM because we have 1 kΩ. One kΩ, you have 9 sign. Okay, so this is strong phase I just mentioned. In the Haiyang and the Jiangwen's approach, the Su eta equal to 0, but we found that it's about 15 degrees. It's not 0. Certainly it's small, but it's not 0. Okay, so you can see if there's an exact SU3 single breaking, pi and kΩ are the same, then for example the contribution from these three modes will be 0. So you can see that indeed the actual mixing comes from the symmetry breaking, SU3 single breaking. Yeah. So and this is a formula for the PB mode. And so we got this value, YPP 10 to minus 3, 1. And 1, also 1. PB also 1. Okay. It's not as big as 0.3. It's not, is it? And compared to the precision here, you can see we improve the theoretical uncertainty very much. So as I said, they approach based on SU3 symmetry. So in principle, they cannot calculate, they can predict one. So they have to rely on data input, and then they have to assume strong weight equal to zero. So then the data uncertainty sum up And so then, so you, if based on this result, we cannot tell whether we can understand child mixing standard model or not. But for this one, we can say, at least we can say, it's impossible to understand child mixing, okay, in 2-body decay model. It's impossible. Still small. So we have checked the D2VV models. But because they are not sufficient data to determine the D2VV, the parameters in the D2VV. Because D2VV involves the three population states. So we need more of three parameters. So, but it's okay. We can just, at least we can try to estimate the contribution from the D2VV model. So we just apply PV from the set to VV with some longitudinal population. Okay, we just do this as a test and see how big the VV contribution is. And we found that it's very, very small. So that means that it doesn't matter. Even we cannot calculate the D2VV contribution precisely, but we know it's negligible. So you can see there's a permutation. Okay, this is the form factor associated with the D2VV in
What's the reason that VV is negligible?
Because there's a smaller SUC breaking, smaller. So this is what we found out. So, and then this is the permutation for the W change. Okay. So, and we found that you can see our prediction for B2BV look reasonable. So you can see we can only predict the longitudinal branch ratio. The experimental is gave a total branch ratio. But for this mode, okay, they give also the longitudinal branch ratio. And you see they're consistent with each other very well. And for most of our predictions are smaller than the total decay branch ratio. So this also reasonable. But except this mode is 11, okay, but we got 37. But we found that the data is very old, it's 1992. So we don't need to worry about it. So the environmentalists should measure all these modes as soon as possible. So now we can, so based on this result, we can estimate the Y to VV, 0.28 times 10 minus 3, basically it's negligible. So even we include the transverse population, it won't help much because we know that if the longitudinal is a dominant contribution and it just gave us 0.2 times 10 minus 3, so it's basically negligible. Okay, so this so we sum up PP and PV in the function, we can only expect 0.21. So it means that with high precision, okay, the decision is very, the uncertainty is very small. With high precision, we found that D2 PP, PV, VV modes, which sum amount up to the 50% ratio of D decay already, and we found that the contribution to the Y is small, far below experimental value, far below. So it means other two body mode, like PT, VT, or AA, or SP, or all these other two-body modes, or multi-particle, multi-body modes, like three-particle, four-particle, final states, should be relevant. So we basically confirm Gronau and Rosenau's conjecture. Multi-body modes, in fact, more important. So that means that if we want to use the exclusive approach to understand child mixing, it's basically not practical, because we really have no idea how to handle the multi-body decay modes. We don't know how to handle it. We can handle two body, but we don't know how to handle three body or even four body. That's almost hopeless. So it's not practical to understand the child mixing in exclusive approach, because you have to calculate the contribution for each mode, and that's too difficult. And then we found the multi-particle mode more important. So it's basically hopeless. And then also, I've shown you that it's impossible to understand child mixing in an inclusive approach because Hadron quark duality fails. So to understand child mixing, we need a new strategy. We really need a new strategy. Not inclusive approach, not exclusive approach. We need new strategy. So please stay tuned. So it means that we have got the new strategy already. So I hope I can share it with you next time. Okay, I stop here.
Okay, thank you. So this is actually the seminar one.
Yeah, seminar one.
So you will tell us that your new method.
Your new method.
How far is your new strategy?
It's completely different from this. Completely different.
Completely different.
Completely different. Yeah.
Because the calculation is too complicated.
Too complicated. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Any questions to the speaker?
So, what is your C over T for the PP and PV modes?
C over T is written in our paper, and I think remember it's quite big.
Okay.
Quite big. Phase,
how
big.
Does it compare with say the level K pi direct CP?
or is it?
Let's say, how does it compare with
C of T?
BDK.
Yeah, in BDK, C of T is small. Here, C of T is quite big. Yeah, C of T is quite big. I don't know whether John Wayne has that impression.
I don't know. Okay. Somewhere 0.6, 0.7.
Yeah, so it's quite big. Yeah. 0.6. So I remember it's 0.5, so it's quite big. Yeah. And then BDK is about 0.3.
Okay, so if there's no question, we can talk privately.
Thank you.